I'm Heng Li. I'm an assistant professor at Dana-Farber and Harvard, and I would like to thank the organizers to give me the opportunity to present my work here. And today I'm going to talk about this haplotype-resolved assembly of long accurate reads, and more exactly, more specifically, this is the HiFi reads from PacBio. I think everyone here knows what's the de novo assembly. I think it's well known that we use de novo assembly to build the reference genomes for new species. And most of the existing assembler can play this role. But although we can do much better now, you will see it later. But what is not well known is that de novo assembler is also the ultimate solution to the calling of complex variants. And for this role, I think it requires to reconstruct both haplotypes. And this is where our contribution comes in. And so this, I will just show example, I mean, how the de novo assembly plays a role in calling complex variants. Here, this the IGA screenshot of this, the LPA gene regions. And you can see here, this is the IGA screenshot. This is the region. This is the 40 kb region. You can see the short reads here, the short reads mapping here, and this long reads, high five reads mapping here. And you can see for short read, there's lots of gaps. Yeah, I mean, there's a huge pileup of reads. This is over 100 fold of coverage. And you can see the very uneven coverage. And for high five reads, better. I mean, you can see all the regions are covered by reads. However, you can see this region, this 300 fold coverage, is much higher than the average. And you can see there clearly something going wrong, but you are not sure what's going wrong. But then you look at the high five assembly on the top. This is the paternal haplotype and the maternal haplotype. You can see just very cleanly two conics going through the entire regions. You can see, you may not see the numbers. This is about 30 kb long insertions into this region, into this RPA gene. And this is 60 kb insertion. It's very cleanly represents this region, much cleaner than retreatment mapping. And here's another example. This is another gene. This is GTF2IRD2. This gene. You can see at the bottom, you can see the long reads alignment. I mean, you can see this assembly gap. There's no reads mapping to these regions. But if you look at the assembly, this is again this the trio assembly. You can see these two lines, paternal and maternal, and they're fully assembled to this region. You can see there are actually variants. For example, here the exact variant here. You can clearly see the variants here. But if you use the reads, you won't see it. This is showing the power of this HiFi long reads assembly. Once you do the assembly, you can recover genetic difference that you wouldn't observe from short reads, for short reads or from HiFi reads. And so the next question is, how many of these genes are there? I mean, are there many? And so here is the classification of structural variations by count, but we just count the structural variation. If it's a 100 base pair structural variation, we count it as one. If it's a 10,000 base pair structural variation, we still count it as one. This is by count. And you can, and the, on the axes, you can see the repeated classes, ALU, L1, VNTR, STR, etc. And here you can see if by count, about a quarter of structural variations are ALU in those. These ALU in those are about 320 base pair in those in the human reference genome. But the other class, middle class, is VNTR. You can see the explanation here about VNTR. And the color here indicates the number of alleles. For the red one, meaning that these are biallelic structural variation. There's only either, I mean, with ALU or without ALU. But VNTR is more complicated. There's, you start to see multiple allelic sequences. And so the previous example, I mean, the example, the RPA gene and also this gene show here will mostly coming from this part. I mean, this green part. You can say, I mean, this is only a couple percentage of the, I mean, the whole, the number of SVs, and there's only several hundred of them. I mean, but on the other hand, if you do this similar plot just by length. Basically, if you did LU, this 300 base pair, you just sub over the length. You can see which type of transcript variations affect most of the genome by length. You can see this plot is vastly different from the previous one. Although there are lots of LUs, because they are very short, only 300 base pair, and so these only occupy less than 5% of the stratified variations. But on the other hand, this bar, especially this bar, this small green bar, although it's only a couple of percent, but now it becomes, 20, almost 20% over all these stratified variations. This means that although there are not so many of these events, but these events are very long, and these events often harbor genes that affecting immunity and others. And so for this part, for these structural variations, we can use short read to find LU L1 insertion. There are papers about that. However, it will be very difficult, close to impossible, to call these satellites like the alpha repeats, VNTRs, and these segmental duplications using short reads. Even when you use long reads, you can actually find a lot of these VNTRs. However, it's still very challenging to find these stratified variations in satellites and also this bar. And also this bar, hundreds of genes are affected by complex stratified variations. And these genes are actually evolutionarily important. It's like the brain, they are affecting brain functions, and they are fast evolving genes after the human chimpanzee divergence. And also the genes that under rapid pressure, evolution pressure, like the amylase cluster, affecting how you digest the foods. These are the most important genes in the human genome, but they are understudied. And so this the genome inner bottle consortium, because it's difficult to do the read mapping to find this gene, and so genome consortium is taking the assembly as ground truth to evaluate short read mapping and also the long read mapping. They have this preprint on constructing a new benchmark dataset to evaluate medically important genes, and here this figure is similar. If you look at the older genome inner bottle region, it's fragmented. But if you look at the assembly, this you can see a long count going through the entire 51 kb region. You get information here in this region. This is a similar story. And so with that said, you can see this medically important genes can only be found by the long read assemblies. And so with that, I will go into the methods about how we reconstruct this assembly, and especially for deeper samples, in this kind of human ideal deployed. And so in this figure, just to give a background, in this figure on the top, this is a real genome, because human is deployed, and we have two haplotypes, one from mother, one the other from the father. And these red dots indicating the heterozygous alleles. And for most of the older assemblers, most of the existing assemblers, they will collapse the two haplotypes together. You will see this basically, and when there's a heterozygous allele, it sort of randomly choose between the paternal and maternal allele. In this example, for the at this heterozygous, it choose the red one, say this maternal, and for this one, the paternal. It's kind of random. In a long count, it's random separation between the two alleles. And then in 2016, Jason Chin developed this Falcon and Zip. It's an improvement to the collapse assembly. You can see in this plot, DD is composed of a primary assembly and also an alternate assembly. On the primary assembly, there's the switch are rare. In the case, you can see that there are long phase blocks. This is red, maternal, and paternal. You can see long phase block. Although the alternate assembly is still fragmented. And then there's another type of assembly. Also, Jason developed this Peregrine. It is first assembly to generate it. I call it the dual assembly. That is, both of the assembly are similar to the primary assembly. There are rare switching maybe between the two paternal maternal haplotypes, but this assembly gives you a complete diploid genome. And the even better assembly, this I call it Haplotype-Resolved assembly. We can face all the heterozygotes on the county. This I would suppose to face all of them. And so here's another way to view the different type of face assemblies. And I'm moved here to the sides. You can see here, this is the primary alternate pair. This is the dual assembly and the haplotype-resolved assembly. And in this figure, in all this six figure, the x-axis shows the number of paternal chimers, the paternal specific chimer. The chimer is only specific to the father. And also maternal specific chimers on the y-axis. And so you can see for the trio assembly here, you can see all the counties are clearly separated. These counties are either is fully paternal or fully maternal. There's nothing in between. And also because we use the parent information in this assembly, as we can also clean separate all the paternal and maternal counties. And this is the haplotype-resolved assembly. And so this, if you look at the primary assembly is quite long. You can see because there are more number of chimers indicating that these counties are longer. However, if you look at the alternate assembly, these blue dots, you can see these alternate assembly are much shorter. Although, I mean, there are no blue dots in between, meaning that these alternate counties actually they are representing a entire haplotype, but they are very short. And there is something in between this trio assembly and the primary assembly is this dual assembly. You can see that both of counties are very long, but I mean these are not cleanly separated. So this is a different type of assembly. And so talking about this assembly, we can only do face assembly back in 2018. Before that, we can't do face assembly. And when we did the face assembly, initially did the face assembly for human genome, that assembly was very fragmented. The N50, the measurement of the contiguity is only, you can see this average conic size is only 1 megabase. This is much shorter than the current assembly. Also, imagine that actually even ultra-long read can be this long, meaning that, I mean, this county, the county size is actually comparable to the downtown read length. It's very fragmented. And so a key challenge in the face assembly is the signal to noise ratio. By that time, in 2018, we got rates about 5 to 10% error rates, meaning there's one error every 10 base pair. And so, but the human heterozygosity is only 0.1%. And so this is over 50 times higher. The error rate is 50 times higher than the heterozygosity. If you want to do face assembly, if you want to separate the haplotypes, I mean, this is the signal. Here's the signal. And errors are bad backgrounds. You need to find signals, in a very noisy background. And so this is very hard. And so this is why, they can only get fragmented assembly. And even when they get the face error rate is very high. But what's different is this. In 2019, just a year after this trio binning assembly, PacBio developed this HiFi reads. This HiFi is also called the high fidelity refresh reads. And these reads are long and accurate. You can see in the plot, on the x-axis is the read length. On the y-axis is the error rates in log scale. Both are in the log scale. And you can see the element reads, they are short and accurate. And the long reads, long reads, they are long, but their error rates is very high. And high rates, they basically combine the advantage both of both exomerase and non-zero long reads. It's not as long as long reads, but it's actually more accurate than the exomerase. And I would say this is a game changer every 5 years. And currently, most existing assemblers are not taking full advantage of this high accuracy of the hyper arrays, and that's why we developed this hyper assembler. Just briefly, give a brief overview of this algorithm, and I will tell you go into detail in the next few slides. So here, just give an overview. I mean, here it does the error correction. Although hyper arrays are very accurate, but we want to get even more accurate reads. Then we do error correction to correct the hyper array almost error free. And then with the almost error free reads, we construct the overlap graph. This is the graph, and then we use the actual information to separate the haplotype. I mean, we see here we call the bubble. These are two haplotypes. We can separate them out into two assemblies. This paper is published in Nature Methods earlier this year. So going to a little bit more details. This is the first step, the error correction step, and it's a HaplotypeSM is doing the haplotype aware error correction. This is different from the previous error correction. They would mix the different haplotypes, but HaplotypeSM that doesn't mix the haplotypes. And here in this example, the red read, the black bar is the target. Each bar is a read, and the black bar is the target read. We want to correct errors on these reads. Then we do the always overlapping and find the reads that overlap with the target reads. And this red reads are overlapping with this one. This you can see the overlaps, and blue reads overlap with this one. And next we select the effective size. These sites are occurring multiple times having two alleles, and both alleles occurring multiple times in the reads. In this case, I mean this red allele occurring three times in red reads and three times in blue reads. We know this should be either kilozygotes or a paralogous difference. We use these sites, and we can know that and on the black read target reads, and this allele is red, then we know this actually should come from the red allele, and then we can use the red reads to do error correction, and we ignore the blue reads. And on these sides, when we look at these sides, because all red reads have this green allele, and so we know this pink one is probably a single error, so we can correct it. And this is how we do the error the haplotype aware error correction. The next step is to do to construct the overlap. I will brief on here. It's basically we have see the read overlaps again. These color circles are the alleles. We can find the overlap between them, and then we can construct the county from that. And after we construct the graph, we use additional information to face the graph. For then, if we have the parental information, we can mark the parental alleles. This is the maternal alleles and paternal alleles for them, and this is showing an example on real data sets. And each bar represents a unit tick, is a part of the counting sequence. And the red allele coming from the mother, and the blue one coming from the father. And you can see in this graph, there's cleanly, you can see the clean path of the maternal allele. If you just trace the red part, you get the maternal allele, maternal context. And then if you trace the blue part, you get the paternal context. And this is how it works. And on real data, this is showing the counting N50, the contiguity, the different species. This human here, this mouse, maize, strawberry, frog, and redwood. You can see in terms of contiguity, HaplotypeSM, this red bar, is considered better than all the other assemblers. And for assembler developers probably know that it's not. I mean, when we evaluate a assembly, I mean, the assembly quality also matters. And here we introduce a new metric to evaluate the assembly quality in difficult regions. And we call it the percent MMC, means a percent multi-copy genes in reference that are missing in the assembly. And here it gives an example. And suppose there's a second module duplication in the reference genome. This is a true haplotype. Suppose there are copy number variation here. And there are two copies. And so if we are doing a good job, we should be able to reconstruct both copies. But often, if the two copies are very similar to each other, I mean, assemblers often produce either a misassembly. In this case, I mean, they only reconstruct one copy, or they introduce an assembly gap here because they're not sure where these two copies are disconnected and are connected. And so in both cases, we only have one copy here. And so we would miss one copy of the genes. And so we use this approach to evaluate the different assemblies. You can see that for the Hebei system, also Hebei canoe, the error rate is near to zero, which means they have reconstructed almost all the multi-copy genes in the genome. On the other hand, if you look at some older assembly, this is mostly older assembly and also other data types, you often miss 70% of the multi-copy genes. And these genes are affecting immunity and they are under fast evolution and under strong selection. And so if you are missing this gene, actually you are missing a good part of the story of the species. That's why it's very important to recognize these genes. And on this matrix, Haplotype-Resolved and Haplotype-Resolved are vastly superior to all the other assembly and also the data set. And it's a similar story for the deep processing samples. And Haplotype-Resolved is the assembler, because of this superior performance on the human assembly. And so Haplotype-Resolved has been chosen by the Human Pangenome Reference Consortium as the single assembler to assemble the admitted first batch of sample. You can see this is the assembly of these model humans. And you can see that this N50, most of them are around 50 megabase. And I want to comment that every single assembly in this plot, even the worst one, is better than all the other assemblies before 2019. This is how the Haplotype-Resolved is superior to the other assemblers. And so the above, when I talk about Haplotype-Resolved assembly, I'm now mostly doing this trio assembly. We are using the parental information, including the human pendulum data. We have sequence data parents. But in practice, it can be tricky to obtain the parental information, to obtain the parents' parental samples. I mean, there could be ARB issues, or the parent has the disease, or if it's for a wild animal, you may not count their parents. And so it's very important that we can do single individual assembly. And so also earlier this year, we published this paper using the Hi-C to do the assembly. And then we refined our algorithm in our new manuscripts that can we can do the assembly that's achieving comparable accuracy to the traditional binning. We also introduced a dual assembly, which we introduced before, and this is similar here. This is a trio assembly, this Hi-C assembly. One difference between the trio and Hi-C is that with trio, because we know the parental information, we can clearly separate the parent, the father and mother. We know which counties are mother, and we know which counties are father. However, for Hi-C, because in a human cell, I mean, you can't really distinguish paternal haplotype or maternal haplotype without sequencing the parents. And so although all the counties have been faced, you can see, I mean, all the counties, they are either paternal or maternal. However, we cannot, I mean, when we separate the two set of counties, we don't know which counties come from mother, which come from father. This is why, I mean, there's a mix on the either x-axis or Wi-Fi access. But overall, still, the contiguity, you can see the lengths are similar, and also they are fully mapped. Every county is haplotype specific. And so with that, I want to give a conclusion. I want to conclude this talk. I want to say that the quality of the haplotype assembly is unprecedented. It's so far, and DBHi's assembly is only possible with PacBio high fidelity data so far. I mean, but Nanopore is making good progress as well. They have this Q20 chemistry in development and also this duplex protocol. And so I believe in the near future, we may be able to apply the same algorithm to the Nanopore data as well. And also, we did a high five for HiFi SNN for the HiFi read assembly. This is one of the two best. If you want to assemble a new species, this is one of the two best choice for new species. And if you want to do population scale sequencing, you want to cause complex variants, and so far HiFi SNN is the only choice. And as I said at the beginning, I believe this is assembly is the ultimate solution to the variant calling. Actually, I imagine in future, we will do assembly first and then do the variant calling. Actually, we may even discard the drop rates. At last, I want to thank my group at Dunn-Farber and Harvard. Haoyu is the developer of HypeSam, and Xiaowen developed Meta. And I have collaborators with others, and also, I'm a key contributor to the Human Panel projects. Thank you for your attention.